Hello and welcome back to the Cubase Fundamentals course. Today we're having a bit of a detour. I've not even loaded Project 1 up, and we're going to have an examination of the Media Bay, which is all about presets and database management inside Cubase. It might sound really dull, but if you can get your hands around Media Bay and really get it working for you, it is an incredibly powerful tool and you can do some really cool things with it. Before we have a look at that, just check out the Patreon link below if you're enjoying this content and you want to help support me and my channel. That's the best way to do it. Okay then, the Media Bay is a database. It lives on PCs, it lives in this folder, and it's called MediaBay3.db. Macs have a different path. I'll put it in the description below. And this is it. This is the database. Every preset stored in Cubase lives inside this thing. If you're worried about losing all of this information, if your PC crashes or whatnot, if you take a backup of this Cubase, whatever version you're currently running at, you'll be absolutely safe. The reason I mentioned that is because you can spend an awful lot of time configuring Media Bay. I've spent glorious hours, many, many hours, just rating presets. I love sorting and rating and categorizing, making spreadsheets. That kind of stuff is fantastic. And so I spend a lot of time playing around in Media Bay. And today I'm going to show you each of the different kind of preset types that we've got to go at. At the moment, we're seeing everything that we've told Media Bay to look at. On the left-hand side, you've got this file browser, which tells Cubase which folders on your PC to be interested in. Now you can see all of these boxes are ticked. By no means the entire PC is being scanned. We've got an option in our settings to hide folders that aren't scanned. If I turn that off temporarily, you'll see lots of gaps. So you can actually configure where your presets are. A lot of it comes out of the box when you first install Cubase. It takes care of all of its factory settings. You don't have to worry about any of that. And it'll point you at all sorts of user folders as well. But there are occasions where if you've got your own sample packs, for instance, you'll have to tell Cubase where they live. Now I've got a couple of places where almost all of my sample data lives. So you can see here's my S drive with sample data in it. And you can see that lots of white ticks, which means that entire folder and all of its subfolders have been scanned. So we want to have a look at each of these different preset types in turn. I'm going to turn all media types off. I'm going to start with audio files. And you can see that we've got some categories across the top. There are six columns. Now, the ones that you can see here are my favorites. I've configured Media Bay for my own use. You can drop down these little windows and choose any columns that you want, but these are my favorites. And I'm going to choose guitar. And now you can see it's filtered down to 3,482 audio WAV files that contain guitar-based samples. So I'll just pick one of these files at random and you'll hear audio start to play almost immediately. So this preview window down at the bottom is worth its weight in gold. It's really good. You've got your own independent preview level, independent of the project. And the autoplay feature is activated with this little button here. Just to the right of it is another great little button called Align Beats to Project. That will basically ensure that any audio that you pick is going to play along with your existing song. So I've got a little Groove Agent groove set up here. I'll get that going. And now if I turn the sample back on, it automatically syncs every time I pick a new audio file. It's time stretching the audio to play in sync with my project. That's the audio file I want. I'm going to drag it into my project, pick it up and drag it across. And you can see that it's mysteriously exactly aligned to the grid pattern. If I open it in the editor and we have a look at this WAV file, you can see that it's by default set me into musical mode, which basically means it's time stretched the WAV file. Now you can override that behavior. If I turn musical mode off, then it's now playing the WAV file at native resolution, but of course it's now going to be out of sync with my project. So it's entirely up to you. You know, we're not having a discussion about audio warp today, but just as a heads up, you know, that's why it was auto-aligned to the project, and why Media Bay was able to play that sample without me actually dragging it into the project. Now, you can rate both WAV files and MIDI files, and the information will be stored in the file itself. If Cubase has write access to the WAV file, it'll actually store this rating inside inside the file itself, but it's also stored in Media Bay. That's the most important thing. So we've now rated that sample. And so if I remove all of my filters and go back to just the guitar plucked, now I can say, show me the 4-star rated values, and there it is. I take that filter away. Another way to access our ratings is from the drop down at the top of the window. Now, the difference between these two things, if I click the one in the column, if I click the 3-star audio in the column, it shows me only the results that are exactly 3 stars, whereas the drop down at the top of the Media Bay is inclusive. So if I select 3 stars here, it'll show me all the 3, 4, and 5-star rated files, as you can see. Some of these filters are cumulative, so I can pick clean, and then if I hold the control key down and select another value, it will show me all the samples that are both clean and dark. Choose this one here, and we scroll across to the character. So here are all the character flags that have been assigned to this sample, and you can see clean and dark. Now, a lot of the stuff that comes with Cubase, the samples are actually locked. They're stored in these things called VST sound files. So you won't actually find the WAV files themselves on disk. You can go through a process whereby if you drag the file into your project and then bounce it, then that will replace the event, and that will create a brand new WAV file in your pool. So if we go into the pool now, there's the WAV file I just created. In your own sample folders, where you've actually got genuine WAV files, then you're completely free to do whatever you want with them. The reason why the results set is empty at the moment is because I've just selected a folder that doesn't have these attributes set. So you'll need to basically clear your filters down if you change views. And I've just realized I have my ratings filter set as well. So if I select one of these samples, I now have the opportunity to tag it as much as I want. Thank you very much. So I can go into character, just basically clicked in the value box, and I can set whatever parameters I want. I can give it a subcategory if I want. So all of my bells are by default. I just set them all to chromatic perk. But I might go in and choose a specific type of subcategory for it. This is a serious rabbit hole. If you get into Media Bay, you might never come out. Next down, we've got MIDI files. And this is another example of choosing new options, being left with an empty results pane and having to figure out why. This time it's because we're specifically looking at the bells folder. If you click the all media icon at the top, then you'll get the entire database. You can also set up favorites. If I was looking at the bells folder and I wanted to remember that was a favorite location that I wanted to go back to, then you click on the add favorite and it'll add it to this list. Basically, as you can see, don't generally tend to use favorites. I look at all of the media all of the time and use my filters to narrow down what it is I'm looking for. So here we've got a bunch of MIDI files, and even though you can see these categories, this won't be a comprehensive list of all of the MIDI files, because if a MIDI file isn't categorized, then there isn't an unselected option. You can't say things that haven't been assigned. I don't know why, it's a bit bad. So to illustrate that, I'll add the category filter option to the results pane below. Click my little settings cog, and then I can head into the musical submenu, choose category, and now that appears at the end, and you can see most MIDI files don't actually have a category assigned to them. So let's pick one that doesn't. And you can see that when I click it, you don't hear anything. That's because the MIDI player needs to be told, if you want to preview information, well, what do you want to use to preview this sound? Well, we can see that it's a hat. So let's connect it to one of the VSTs in this current project. There it is. If I load up an instrument as well, just loaded a piano instrument up here, I can play the same MIDI file through the piano instead. Obviously, it's going to sound like a drums sound being played through a piano. Pick a specifically keyboard-oriented MIDI file. Pick that up. Drag it into the project. I can't remember ever needing to know about system-exclusive data. Just throw it away, and more often than not, you're absolutely fine. So let's see what we've got. So you can see that it's time-stretched the MIDI file to fit into the project. The next option down had me confused for the longest time till I actually figured out what they were. The difference between a MIDI file and a MIDI loop is that a MIDI loop is a little bit like a track preset, which we'll get onto shortly. It is a MIDI file, and it contains the same information as a MIDI file, but it also contains the instrument and track settings that we used to record that data. I'll just select one of these files. Now, that delay that you heard before the sound started playing was the player being loaded. So it's basically, it knows what sound this MIDI loop was recorded with. So the first thing that I'll do is treat it like I would any other MIDI file and drag it onto my piano track. Now what you're going to hear is those MIDI notes being played through a piano. I'm going to delete that file now. And instead of dragging the file onto a track, I'm going to double click it. Now the entire MIDI loop's been loaded. This instrument is Hellion, and it's been loaded with the electric piano preset that was used to record that MIDI loop. Let's have a quick look at its channel settings as well. Yeah, we've got a couple of inserts. So you can see there's a ping pong delay and a chorus being inserted on this track. So all insert effects and all channel strip, you can see there's some EQ settings being made there. They're all carried along with a MIDI loop. So it's actually at the top of the hierarchy as far as Cubase presets are concerned, because it's an instrument and musical data. So now if I play that track, that's what the MIDI loop's expected to sound like. Next in the list, we've got pattern banks. These are funny old things. So pattern banks are created using the Beat Designer. So if I double click one of these things, well, first of all, let's hear one. So that's an instance of Groove Agent with a beat being constructed in a VST called Beat Designer. If I double click the track, now you'll see that this is an instance of Groove Agent. There it is. But you can see that there are no patterns. The pattern isn't coming from inside Groove Agent. It's coming from the MIDI insert Beat Designer. And this thing here, which I will confess I don't use, has been used to create that beat. And it's way too loud, as I've just discovered. I do my grooves in Groove Agent, so I don't tend to use Beat Designer, but pattern banks are there for you if you want to play with them. Track presets are another one of those things that it's really easy to overlook, but they're actually baked quite deep into Cubase. If we have a look at the main interface, next to the plus button, which we've used multiple times during this project, there's a Use Track Preset button, and you might never really have given it a second thought. But if you click that, it loads this dialogue with an absolute mass of information in it. I just close my filter down. So if I choose one of the standard Steinberg plugins, just choose one of these. Pretty much at random, you can see it's loaded Halion, and it basically saves you the trouble of having to load the instance and then a preset in. It bakes those two things into one. Now, the primary reason I use track presets is with sends, because send effects are a real pain to have to configure individually, but there's a shortcut way that you can use with track presets. I am not going to pretend that this is elegant. It's anything but it does work. What I'm going to do is I'm going to create one audio track. Then I'm going to create two send effects tracks. Doesn't matter what I create, that's irrelevant. Now I'm going to pick all three of those tracks together. Right click, load track preset. And this preset here, full board with delay and reverb, is specifically configured to overlay on top of one audio track plus two effects tracks. So if I click OK, that's just loaded one of my pre-built guitar configs. So if you look in the strip for the guitar track, there are all of my guitar inserts. And then this first track, which I'm going to have to rename manually, contains all of my delays. And this second FX track contains my reverbs. So with a little bit of renaming and a little bit of rerouting, I'm not saying any of this is pretty, but that's the fastest way to load multiple send effects tracks if you use the same things in lots of different projects. But you have to have the correct types of tracks loaded first, select them all, and then load the corresponding track preset over the top of it. Sorry. Plugin presets is my favorite because this is where the plugins live. So this is basically all of your VST instrument presets. Thousands and thousands of them spread across the different instruments. Now the Steinberg stuff is absolutely beautifully integrated with MediaBay. So every Steinberg plugin that you install will come pre-configured into MediaBay. All of its settings will already be there, with all of the character attributes pre-done for you. That's not the case with other vendors. So if I choose an Arturia product, for instance, these presets that you see down here, this very small list, is stuff that I've manually created. If I load an instance of the instrument, you'll see that inside the Arturia product, there's a much greater number of presets, but you don't get access to them immediately. What you basically have to do is, if you've chosen a preset that you really like, let's say this butterfly pad, you really like that effect, now you have to turn it into a MediaBay preset by saving the preset. So you have the opportunity to tag it using your various attributes. If you can't see these, by the way, this little button, Show Attribute Inspector. Choose your various attributes. Click OK. And now that's been saved into MediaBay. Sort by name, and there it is. And you can see that I've not rated it or given it any of the other tags. Typically, if I add something into MediaBay, I will go to the effort of categorizing it. Occasionally, I'll assign character tags as well, but it's not something I'm a huge fan of. Categories and subcategories, yes, I do that a lot. FX chain presets are great. These are used on your insert strips. So if we have a look, for instance, on this audio track that I installed, all these settings here are available as an independent insert strip. So this is basically like part of a preset. You can access them from the little box. See the MediaBay symbol? Wherever you see this, you're going to access the MediaBay. And then we can load FX chain presets. So I can basically overwrite these settings. So you can see it's loaded more than one plugin there in one action. Strip presets are the same kind of thing, but on the other side of the fence. inside every MIDI channel, you've got your inserts, which is where I spend the vast majority of my time, but you do also have a completely independent channel strip. So these are baked into every single track that you create in Cubase. And this gives you the option to add gates and saturation modules and all sorts of stuff. I've never imported a video file into Cubase, so I'll jump over that one. And Projects is literally your bank of projects. If we have a look at what we've got, here is a huge bunch of pre-configured projects that you can basically get up and running with. Now, I don't use projects from the media bay. I use the hub. This is how I access my various standard templates and any projects that I've been working on, but you can access them from inside media bay. So there is a lot. This is the point that I'm making. There is a hell of a lot of stuff that you can do inside media bay. It is a magnificent environment if you can get used to it. It looks very clunky. You know, the interface is a little bit outdated now. But if you can overlook that stuff and just get down to the functionality, you know, it really is pretty powerful. That'll do us for today. Hope you've enjoyed the episode. If you did, please hit the like button. I'll see you next time. Thanks a lot.